to continue with pediatric emergencies, burns and scales. Burns and scales are the second most common accidents occurring in pediatric age group. By scales, we mean it is injury with hot liquids. The resulting injuries can be categorized into partial sickness burn or full sickness burn, depending on the depth of the burn. Okay, by partial sickness, we can categorize it into superficial, affecting epidermis only. In the past, it was called first degree burn. The classic example is sunburn, characterized by erythema, painful lesions that heal rapidly, leaving no scars or sequelae. But when the dermis also is affected, we start to call it the second degree. The second degree burn or the superficial dermal, where epidermis and upper dermis are affected, it is associated with blistering. Okay, and the intense pain due to injury to the nerves present in the upper dermis. Okay, so having a blistering or intense pain, it is superficial dermal or second degree burn. Deep dermal, where epidermis and the deep dermis are affected, now it is painless lesion. Okay, or third degree burn. Okay, when the burn is full thickness, so all epidermis and the dermis are affected, even muscle and bones are burned also. Here the lesion is white with dry skin with no hairs and no sensation and no capillary return. There is complete damage to the nerves and to blood vessels, to hair follicles, to epidermis and the dermis. And here excision and the grafting is required for these injuries. So having a child with severe burn, how to manage? You need to earlier to minimize the duration of exposure to heat. This is very important by use of tepid water, and this should be educated for the population. You need to know that airway can deteriorate rapidly, especially on burns affecting the face and the neck, or even exposure to inhalation injury. So intubation can be difficult later on due to airway edema. Early stabilization of airway is very, very important. In a burned child, you need to consider an occult source of bleeding that may cause him shock, even without any obvious source of bleeding. So internal source of bleeding should be searched for if we have signs of hypovolemic shock or and anemia. High fluid requirement are needed for burned children. And disease fluid requirement should be calculated from the time of injury or the burn and not from the time of arrival of the child to the ER. If you have a circumferential full thickness burn, okay, a burn that affects the whole circumference of the chest, this may impair breathing. And if it is circumferential burn affecting the lung, it may end by compartmental syndrome and perfusion, impairment of perfusion to the lung that may end by complete loss of the lung. Okay, so you should be aware of this, where an escharotomy or division of the escher should be done. This escher, which is a scab that is caused by thermal burn. Okay, so escharotomy is done to lessen the pull on surrounding tissues and to relieve the pressure exerted by this escher. Consider that you may have cervical spine injury and severe burn injuries. Inhalation injury, if you have a history of exposure to smoke in a confined place like house fires, for example, so search for inhalation injury is essential. This can be indicated by presence of black sputum, okay, or by presence of soot deposits around nose or mouth or on clothes. This is a bronchoscope that show presence of soot deposits due to inhalation of smoke. Inhalation of smoke can be associated by inhalation injury, edema of airway and its obstruction, pneumonitis, and so on. assessment of burn injury in a child depend on calculation of the total body surface area affected by the burn, okay? Plus assessment of thickness or depth of the burn, as we have just mentioned. It is full thickness or partial thickness. So you should assess total body surface area affected by the burn and the thickness or depth of the burn. Rule of nine, that is applicable in adults, not applicable in children, but a pediatric chart should be used. Okay, this is pediatric chart used to calculate the total body surface area affected by the burn, and based on this calculation, determination of severity and management plan is done. So what is the treatment of a burn injury? Again and again, the ABCDE approach is very important, starting with early stabilization of the airway by intubation can be life-saving due to the risk of airway edema. You add to the approach F, which is the fluid replacement in case of burn has special importance. Okay, so supply with high flow oxygen, insert IV lines, give analgesia, very important, early and adequate analgesia. In case of burn that affect more than 10% body surface area, so extra fluid is indicated plus the maintenance fluid. This fluid is calculated, as we have mentioned, from the time of injury, not from the time of arrival to the hospital, using the Parkland formula for Hartmann's fluid volume to calculate the fluid volume needed as a replacement. In this case, that should be given over 24 hours. We use the Parkland formula. This formula you may not remember, but this formula depends on the body surface area and the weight of the child. Okay, the calculated amount of fluid should be given as half of it in the first 8 hours. Okay, and the other half should be in the next 16 hours. After the first 24 hours and the replacement of the fluids, the maintenance fluids should be given and guided by the amount of urine output. So urinary catheter should be introduced, the fluid chart should be done, and keeping urine output more than 2 milli per kg per hour is essential in these cases. There is high risk of rapid heat loss following a burn injury, so you need to recover the child after the initial stabilization to keep him warm and minimize the heat loss. Escharotomy for circumferential burn is very important. Consider carbon monoxide poisoning in any patient who is exposed to burn in a confined space. So inhalation of smoke may result in carbon monoxide poisoning. Carbon monoxide results in carbon monoxide binding to hemoglobin, forming the carboxyhemoglobin. Carboxyhemoglobin has a much higher affinity for oxygen than the normal hemoglobin. So this will impair the oxygen delivery to tissues, ending by cellular hypoxia, despite we have normal saturation by pulse oximetry. And for this reason, pulse oximetry is not considered as 100% reliable indicator of tissue oxygenation, as even with normal saturation by pulse oximetry, we have carboxyhemoglobin that has affinity to not deliver oxygen to tissues. The treatment for such a situation will be by 100 oxygen supplementation or even hyperbaric oxygen to overcome the carbon monoxide binding to hemoglobin. Complications of burn injury include sepsis, okay, and the toxic shock syndrome. Sepsis is the most common cause of morbidity associated with burn, as you now, after injury to the skin, you have entry of the pathogen to circulation. And unfortunately, fever is not a specific predictor of infection in these children, because fever is already present as a part of the inflammatory response accompanying the burn, or the systemic inflammatory response syndrome, CIRS, that occurs in case of infection, in case of burn, in case of trauma, surgery, so for many causes. So other indicators of sepsis may indicate the high level of CRP and the intolerance of enteral feeding and the high index of suspicion to start aggressive antibiotic therapy. The other complication is toxic shock syndrome. Even small and clean burns can provide an entry for the stage of commensals in the skin, and some strains of these produce the dangerous toxin that is called the toxic shock syndrome toxin 1. This toxin results, as we have discussed in the chapter of infection, in a widespread cytokine storm and inflammatory response that fatal, that can be fatal in a high percentage of the patients. So in a burned child having sudden deterioration with high grade fever associated with systemic manifestations in the form of GIT manifestations like vomiting and the diarrhea, skin manifestations like rash, and circulatory failure due to the widespread vasodilation. In this case, aggressive introduction of antibiotics is important, and the antibodies against the toxin that can be supplied as human immunoglobulin concentrate or by fresh frozen plasma. Unfortunately, mortality is up to 50% in this situation. So when to refer to a burn center? When you have 10% of body surface area affected by partial sickness burn, or in case of full sickness burn affecting 5% of body surface area. Special areas like face, hands, feet, or perineum should be referred to a burn center. Having circumferential burn also should be referred. Significant inhalation burn should be referred. Chemical burn, radiation, or high voltage burns should be referred. What about chemical burn? Sometimes you find a question in the exam I'm asking you about alkali burns. Alkali burns are more serious than acid burns. Why? They penetrate more deeply. They digest the proteins and the tissues and penetrate more deeply. Okay, so having a dry powder on the skin, you should brush this powder before you irrigate, and then you irrigate with water for about 20-30 minutes as a resuscitation maneuver. A specific type of burn injury is the electrocution injury. Having faulty electrical appliances in living rooms may be a cause for exposure of children to electrocution injury. Also, struck by lightning is a source for electrocution injury. Here, what are the risks of electrical injury? The risk for cardiac arrest, okay, is high, which is related to the size of the current, duration of exposure to the current, and whether this current is alternating or direct current. Okay, when a child holds a source of electrical source, so tetany may occur in the muscles, which result in the child clenching on the electrical source. Presentation by ventricular fibrillation arrest is common. Dysrhythmia is also common and can present late, so monitoring for the cardiac rhythm is vital. Examining for entry and the exit of the electrical burn should be done. Also, other injuries can accompany the electrical burn, even cervical spine injury. You should determine the path of the current, okay, which will take the path of the least resistance from the point of entry of the electrical current to the earth. Fluid and the blood have the least resistance, okay, then skin, bone, which have the highest resistance. So we should examine the body for the site of entry of the current, okay, and then follow its pathway till its exit at the earth, okay? And we may expect that the pathway would follow the least resistant tissues. And this includes blood and the fluids away from skin and bones, okay? And we should determine this best to determine injuries that have resulted from this electrical current. The damage is caused by heat, okay, where nerves, blood vessels, skin, and the muscles are damaged the most. After injury, swelling of tissues occurs, especially in muscles, and this can lead to compartmental syndrome. This is a picture of compartment syndrome due to swelling in muscles, okay, and in confined closed areas. And this compartment may end by impairment of perfusion, ischemia, and gangrene, and the loss of the affected part. So early intervention is essential. Myoglobinuria is a consequence of electric injury that may end by renal failure. So in case of electrical injury, you should disconnect from source of electrocution as a first step. You may immobilize or need to immobilize cervical spine in case of suspicion of injury. Follow the ABCDE approach by maintaining the airway, checking breathing, giving oxygenation, checking circulation, starting compressions if no pulse, and checking conscious level, and removal of clothes, and removal of any sources of danger. Greater fluid requirement is needed because of internal heat injury caused by the electrical current, despite relatively small external burn. At the site of entry of the electrical burn may be small, but the internal heat can be maximal, resulting in greater fluid requirement. Should be calculated and monitored carefully. Myoglobinuria, or release of myoglobin into urine. Okay, so myoglobin is released after muscle injury. This may be crush injury, after traffic accident maybe, or after electrocution. Release of myoglobin from muscles is excreted through the renal tubules into urine, resulting in red urine. And the myoglobinuria is one of the differential diagnoses of red urine. Okay, plus hemoglobinuria, that is caused by intravascular hemolysis, plus hematuria, that is caused by presence of RBCs in urine, maybe as a consequence of glomerulonephritis. And also other differential diagnoses included use of some medications like metronidazole that caused red urine. So myoglobin can be detected in urine, and this is the diagnosis. The danger of myoglobinuria is myoglobin can be precipitated in renal tubules, okay, resulting in its obstruction, ending by obstructive uropathy and post-renal failure. Okay, obstructive uropathy ending by renal failure due to obstruction of renal tubules and impairment of glomerular filtration. So this is a challenge that required forced alkaline diuresis, which means we need to keep the urine output more than 2 milli per kg per hour by fluid loading, okay, in addition to the use of potent diuretics like mannitol, okay, and another measure to add IV sodium bicarb in order to alkalinize the urine and so help excretion of myoglobin and preventing its precipitation in renal tubules. This forced alkaline diuresis is used for also aspirin and phenobarbital overdose following the same mechanism to increase their excretion in urine. Drowning, the third most common accidents in the pediatric age group after road traffic accident and burns. By drowning, we mean we have primary respiratory impairment from immersion in a liquid medium. So when a child is immersed under a liquid medium, this is a pathogenesis where first reflex occur is diving reflex formed of bradycardia and apnea. And after apnea, a secondary hypoxia will develop from the acidosis, and this will end by reflex tachycardia and increase in blood pressure, which will followed by stoppage of apnea and breathing. Breathing will lead to fluid inhalation that will result in laryngeal spasm, and after subsidence of this spasm, aspiration of fluids into lungs will occur, ending by alveolitis and pulmonary edema. How to manage a drowning child? So early management at the waterside is very, very important in the outcome of drowning management. Starting with the ABCD approach, always ABCD approach. So airway and breathing, you need to avoid aspiration by the fluids ingested. So you need to intubate the child, okay, and to do gastric decompression by nasogastric tube to avoid aspiration. Always immobilize the cervical spine and assist circulation. Drowning is associated by hypothermia, and the hypothermia is associated with high liability to dysrhythmia. Okay, asystole can occur, pulseless electrical activity, VF or VTEC, all these rhythms can be associating with the drowning and the hypothermia. Then exposure, okay, you need to rewarm the child. The main concern is the hypothermia. So if the temperature of the child is fortunately 32 or more, so you need just to do external rewarming. But if the temperature is less than 32, so you need to do active core rewarming to restore the body temperature. Anticipate the need for volume replacement to counter the rewarming shock. When you are doing a rewarming, so expect that you will have generalized vasodilation, and this may end by shock. So replacement with IV fluids is essential. How to do external rewarming? By removal of cold and wet clothes, by application of warm blankets, infrared radiant lamps, and forced air rewarming blankets. Okay, this is external rewarming, but if the temperature is below 32, other measures are needed for cool rewarming. This includes the use of warm IV fluids up to temperature of 39, warm V ventilator gases, okay, with temperature of 42. This can be done by the ventilator, and gastric or bladder lavage with hot saline. Okay, lavage of peritoneum, pleura, and the pericardium also with hot saline. Extracorporeal blood warming may be done. Okay, for core rewarming. And be cautious that you need to continue measures of resuscitation until the core temperature is 32 or more. Okay, or until you cannot raise temperature despite the prolonged resuscitation maneuver. Careful monitoring of cardiovascular function is vital. Dysrhythmia is very, very common associated with arrhythmia. After you have stabilized the patient, you have done the ABCD approach, and you have checked the rhythm and started the external rewarming or the core rewarming measures. So a secondary survey in hospital, doing a blood glucose for hypo or hyperglycemia, blood gases for metabolic alkalosis or metabolic acidosis, for electrolytes, for any disturbance should be done. You should do the coagulation screen as hypothermia precipitate coagulation disorder. Chest X-ray and the cervical spine imaging is needed. Blood and sputum cultures for risk of infection should be done. You would expect a poor prognosis of the drowning if the submersion were prolonged more than 8 minutes, and after 40 minutes of full cardiopulmonary resuscitation, there is no any breathing effort and no gasp. If you have persistent coma, if acidosis is severe below 7, pH below 7, if you have hypoxia, all these poor prognostic indicators. But if the basic life support measures is provided at the water side, this carry a high favorable outcome. To continue with cold injuries, severe cold injuries may be associated with the frostbite. Frostbite is quite common presentation, especially in some susceptible population on exposure to cold, on exposure to this situation. So immediate treatment is vital to guard against complications in the form of clotting complications or disorder, up to thrombosis and gangrene may occur. Use the warm blankets, use warm drinks, use circulating hot water until the injured part is pink in color, okay, which may take up to 20 minutes. Avoid the use of dry heat, but usually use blankets, usually use drinks and circulating water rather than dry heat to provide warmth. Use analgesia as rewarming can be very painful. Usually monitor the cardiac rhythm, okay, during rewarming. About hypothermia, by hypothermia we mean that the core body temperature is less than 35 degrees, okay? And usually this will be associated by altered consciousness and by arrhythmias and by clotting abnormalities, okay? So rewarming also can lead to a shock due to the generalized vasodilation, especially if the rewarming is rapid. And so rewarming should be carried out over the same period the initial cooling process take, okay? Resuscitation is not measures. If you have a child who is in arrest, okay, due to hypothermia, or maybe after drowning or any other cause for hypothermia, so your resuscitation efforts would not be effective as long as the hypothermia is present. And if you remember the algorithm, hypothermia was the first reversible cause you should search for. Okay, so perform defibrillation for the cardiac dysrhythmia only when the temperature is more than 30. Otherwise, your efforts will not be effective. Okay, and also you should prolong your resuscitation efforts. Okay, not just 30 minutes as in other situations, but it should be prolonged till core temperature is higher than 32. So also the dose interval for adrenaline used in the CPR is doubled when temperature is between 30 and 35, because less response is expected. Your patient should not be assumed dead until you have done rewarming to 32, okay, or ideally even to more than 35. About head injury, okay, when a child is exposed to head injury, maybe due to a traffic accident, maybe after fall from height, maybe inflicted or non-accidental injury or child abuse, so you would expect intracranial pathology. And this intracranial pathology can be primary due to the direct result of trauma, or can be secondary due to indirect consequence of the trauma. Primary insult, this can be focal by the presence of cerebral contusions or lacerations, and this can be directly under the site of the trauma or the impact, or can be on the opposite side. You should remember this. Also, intracranial bleeding may occur, which can be extradural, which is not common, okay, or can be subdural or intracerebral bleeding. Diffuse primary pathology may be in the form of shearing forces that result in immediate axonal damage and the severe brain injury, severe deficits, despite nothing appear in the ordinary imaging. Okay, special forms of MRI needed to diagnose this for this form of shearing forces. Okay, so you know, you need to know that the impact of injury can be focal, okay, in the form of contusion, lacerations, bleeding, or can be diffused in the form of shearing forces, causing a severe deficit without apparent imaging finding. The secondary pathology due to indirect consequence of the primary insult. Also, this can be focal if you have intracerebral hematoma, for example. So underlying this, this will be ischemia of the brain ending by brain infarction and focal deficit. Diffuse effects also, or diffuse intracranial pathology can occur as indirect consequence in the form of brain ischemia. This brain ischemia can result from hypoxia, okay, by the suppression of breathing, or impaired cerebral perfusion due to the raised intracranial pressure, secondary to brain edema, hypercapnia, impaired autoregulation, or hypotension. If you remember, we have said that the cerebral perfusion is dependent on the mean arterial pressure, okay, minus the intracranial pressure. So any cause of increased intracranial pressure, as here after head injury, that may result into brain edema, may result in hypercapnia by impairment of respiratory drive, okay, will end by the reduction of cerebral perfusion and the brain ischemia. Always remember that carbon dioxide is a cerebral vasoconstrictor, while oxygen is cerebral vasodilator. So having hypercapnia or hypoxia will end by cerebral vasoconstriction and increase in the intracranial pressure and reduction in cerebral perfusion, ending by brain ischemia. So what are risk factors, okay, that would indicate you have severe intracranial injury and would necessitate to do a cranial CT within 1 hour of the injury? From history, if you have history of high speed road traffic accident, history of fall from height, high speed projectile or object, okay, this is risk factor. If there is loss of consciousness more than 5 minutes, or if you have amnesia for more than 5 minutes, abnormal drowsiness, 3 or more episodes of vomiting, post-traumatic seizures with no history of epilepsy, clinical suspicion of inflicted injury or non-accidental injury. These are risk factors in the history that would indicate you have severe intracranial injury. From examination, if you have done the Glasgow Coma Scale and you find it less than 14 in age less more than 1 year, and if it is less than 15 and less than 1 year age, this is risk factor. Having a tense fontanelle, having bruises or swelling or lacerations, having suspicion of the breast skull injury or open skull injury, having signs of basal skull fracture, having a focal neurological deficit, okay, signs of lateralization, one pupil is dilated, focal seizure, so any focal neurological deficit, all these risk factors for severe intracranial injury, you must do cranial CT. What are signs of basal skull fracture? You have basal skull fracture if you have blood or CSF leaking from the ear or nose. Okay, if you have bilateral periorbital hematoma or band eyes like this, if you have battle sign or bruising over mastoid, if you have hemotympanum or blood behind the drum, okay, all these are signs of basal skull fracture, and this is serious, okay. If you don't have all of this and you have just a minor head injury with no any risk factors we have mentioned, if your patient is fully conscious and no adverse medical condition in him, he doesn't have bleeding diathesis, or you don't suspect any social factors or non-accidental injury, so your patient does not require a hospital admission, but a clear written advice should be given for him for when to seek medical advice again. But if you have any of these risk factors, so your injury is severe and you should take some measures. The aim of these measures is to prevent further brain injury, okay, by maintaining good oxygenation, by avoidance of hypotension, avoidance of pyrexia that would increase the metabolic needs of the brain, avoid any hypo or hyperglycemia. So these measures to prevent further brain injury. The skull is a closed box that is composed of brain, CSF, arterial and venous blood. Okay, so after injury and increased intracranial pressure, drainage of the arterial and venous blood occur to reduce the pressure inside. But any swellings later on will result in marked increase of the intracranial pressure. Okay, so presence of a swelling in the brain or bleeding inside the brain will increase intracranial pressure, which can be monitored in your patient by slowing of the heart rate, elevation of the systolic blood pressure, dilating pupils, and irregular breathing. We call it the Cushing triad. Again, remember that the cerebral perfusion is dependent on the mean arterial pressure minus the intracranial pressure. So what are measures taken for those patients? You need to maintain adequate cerebral perfusion pressure by keeping higher than normal blood pressure. If you already have adaptation response in the form of high blood pressure, you shouldn't or you must not reduce the blood pressure. Even you may need to use noradrenaline to increase the blood pressure. And then follow measures to reduce the intracranial pressure. These include keeping the head of the patient central and raised in about 20 to 30 degrees. Try to maintain low to normal carbon dioxide. Avoid any hypercapnia, as carbon dioxide is cerebral vasoconstrictor. And keep the CO2 level between 30 to 35. Okay. Also avoid marked hypocapnia, as this would also be harmful to the brain. Maintain high serum sodium, more than 140, to keep the blood pressure. Also maintain high serum osmolarity. You may even give mannitol and the hypertonic saline in order to maintain serum osmolarity and reduce the intracranial pressure. You may drain CSF by a ventricular drain. Minimize any stimulation by giving pain relief and by giving sedation to the patient, even paralyzing the drug to the patient to minimize any stimulation. Avoid also extra sedation, okay? Avoid stimulating procedures like suction, minimize suction. Avoid any seizures, treat seizures if present. Avoid pyrexia, treat pyrexia if present in order to reduce intracranial pressure. The outcome is dependent on the initial Galasko coma scale. If you Galasko coma scale of 8 or less, this means you have deep coma. It is essential to intubate the patient and ventilate him, to immobilize the cervical spine, and to do a cranial CT down to cervical to halos within 1 hour to exclude cervical spine injury and to define any intracranial pathology in the form of bleeding or infarctions, contusions, lacerations, and so on. It is essential to evacuate any expanding bleed as soon as possible by a ventricular drain, okay, to minimize the intracranial pressure. And during the course of your patient in the ICU, you may suspect some complications, including the neurogenic diabetes insipidus, finding that your patient have polyuria associated with increasing serum osmolarity. You may suspect a secondary deficiency of antidiuretic hormone due to the intracranial pathology. Another complication may be the syndrome of inappropriate secretion of antidiuretic hormone or the side itch associated with oligo and dilutional hyponatremia. Okay, all these may occur in the course of treatment of this intracranial pathology.